All right, joining us now on Hot Copy, we have former Senate President Franklin Drilon. Sir, good morning to you.
Good morning. Magandang umaga po. Thank you very much for having me in your program this morning.
It's a pleasure to have you back, sir. An overview for the audience right now. In the 2024 budget, the confidential and intelligence funds amount to a total of 12 billion pesos. So under scrutiny right now are the confidential funds under the Office of the Vice President and under the DepEd, which both of them together amount to something like 650 million. So let's start first with this. What are the parameters in the use of confidential funds?
As far as I can recall, Karen, there are no parameters. Okay, that is why I suggest that the standard should be only those agencies which are involved in gathering confidential and intelligence things should be allowed confidential and intelligence funds. I repeat that. Only those agencies, whether civilian or military, involved in gathering of intelligence should be given in the budget, confidential and intelligence funds, as distinguished from those who are users of this information, which should not be given intelligence funds. Like, for example, very classic. Okay, so you have the AFP. They gather intelligence, so they are entitled by the very nature of their function to intelligence funds, because they gather intelligence. NBI, PNP, they are entitled to confidential and intelligence funds because they are involved in law enforcement. Therefore, that should be the standard. Those who are users of the intelligence and confidential information should not be given confidential and intelligence fund. That should be the clear standard, so that only those, really, I repeat, because this is very important, only those who are involved in gathering confidential and intelligence information should be allotted confidential and intelligence funds. Those who are users should not be involved in intelligence gathering, but get the input from the agencies involved in intelligence gathering. Insofar as oversight functions are concerned, I agree with my colleagues. There should be indeed an oversight function. Unfortunately, the reality in Congress is that it is not convened. In the last 6 years that I was in the Senate, I do not remember. There may be some, but I do not remember having attended an intelligence oversight function meeting. I may be wrong, but in other words, if ever it convened, it must have been so infrequent. I do not remember. And indeed, it is something that should be done. And COA should be invited to those. COA should be invited to those briefings. And maybe we impose the rule in the General Appropriations Act: no further confidential and intelligence funds will be released until the report is submitted to, on a quarterly basis, to the Oversight Committee of Congress. So, it is possible to correct this. Karen, remember that the Pharmaleen deal started with a transfer of 42 billion from the DOH to the DBM procurement service. So these fund transfers are really something that should be monitored closely, because under the Constitution, the President of the Republic, the Senate President, the Speaker of the House, the heads of the constitutional commissions can augment existing budget items. Initially, that's my thoughts.
All right. So let's segregate the issues. First is the 150 million pesos intelligence fund of the DepEd. So you would consider, based on your recommendation, the DepEd as a beneficiary. They're the, in effect, they're not the intelligence gatherer, because the vice president in the hearing said that we use the intelligence funds, I'm rephrasing, because there are several schools that are involved in recruiting students to join the Communist Party or the NPA. So supposed to be, dun nagagamit daw yung 150 million pesos ng DepEd. She says education is linked to national security. And DepEd is a civilian agency. It has a bigger confidential fund than the DND. And now the DA wants a confidential funds of 50 million. The Coast Guard has a confidential fund or intelligence fund of only 10 million. So what do you make first of the DepEd having a confidential fund?
That strengthens my proposal that only those who will gather intelligence should be funded or should be allotted confidential and intelligence funds. DepEd is a user of intelligence gathered. I will not go into how it is being used, etc. But just the point, as a structural, as an organizational concept, only those who gather intelligence and confidential information should be given intelligence funds, because that is their work. Mm-hmm. And the DepEd should get from them the confidential or
information.
Information.
Uh-oh.
that is gathered by these agencies in charge of intelligence gathering. Mm-hmm. That's the basic principle.
Okay, so that's the DepEd. Now, first, do you believe that civilian agencies should still have confidential funds? Or you can actually add and itemize their needs in the budget of the agency?
I'm sorry, Karen, I did not.
Okay. Do you believe that civilian agencies should have confidential funds?
Yes. Civilian agencies who are involved in intelligence gathering. Example, NBI. That's a civilian agency.
Civilian.
But they need confidential and intelligence funds, because they gather intelligence information on criminals. The PNP, the same thing. Only, I repeat, the standard is simple and clear. If you're involved in intelligence gathering, yes, CIF or confidential intelligence funds is proper. If you are not involved in confidential and intelligence gathering, then draw on the information gathered by these agencies. In the example, NBI is a civilian agency. They're entitled by the very nature of the work to confidential and intelligence funds, because you cannot have this an open activity. AFP, PNP, these are all agencies that gather information. Agencies like DepEd or the Department of Health, or whoever, the DNR, etc., should draw the information from these intelligence gathering agencies. And a special provision can be indicated in the budget that intelligence gathering agencies like the NBI, etc., should assist the other agencies in intelligence information. In other words, they should share that information with the other nine agencies. Mm-hmm. A civilian agency is entitled to confidential funds if they're involved in gathering information on that is needed.
Okay, so now let's move on to the confidential funds, the issue that the office of the vice president is facing. So in 2022, Malacañang, the office of the president, released 221.42 million pesos in confidential funds to the office of the vice president under special provision number one of the contingent fund. But then it was discovered that the OVP used the confidential funds under the contingent fund to build satellite offices, satellite OVP offices, 221 million pesos. So first, is that legal?
First, so to answer that question, we must look at the basis of intelligence and confidence and of the transfer. Mm-mm. Under the Constitution, no law shall be passed authorizing any transfer of appropriations from one office to another. I repeat, under the Constitution, no law shall be passed authorizing the transfer of appropriation, because the power to appropriate public funds belongs to Congress and not to anyone else. Now, the Constitution provides an exception, and the exception is the Congress may by law authorize the agencies to augment any item in their in the government, in the GAA from the respective offices from savings in other items in their budget. To repeat and make it simpler, transfers from one agency to the other is prohibited. Exception, when there is a need to augment the item. Now, so that's the first basis. So the question is, was there augmentation valid under the law? I was there, Karen, when this budget was being debated upon in 2022. And there was no request for confidential and intelligence budget from the office of the vice president, then led in 2022 or 2021 by Vice President Lady Robredo. So there was no item. Since there was no item, then you could not augment. The key is augmentation. If there is a zero budget, what can you augment? Because there is no deficiency in the item that needs augmentation. There is no item for confidential and intelligence funds in the office of the vice president when we debated on this budget in 2022.
Okay. Now, sir, Executive Secretary Bersamin, who is, of course, quite an expert on the Constitution, coming from the Supreme Court, being former Supreme Court Justice, has quoted special provision number one of the 2022 contingent fund. He says the president is authorized to approve releases to cover funding requirements of new or urgent activities of national government agencies. So he's quoting special provision number one. So there are two issues here. So can the president make under his discretion what is new or urgent and just disburse it to the office of the vice president without congressional approval? Can he do that?
Karen, in the case of Arroyo versus Aquino, which is the famous PDAF cases, the Supreme Court squarely ruled that the power to augment cannot be used to fund non-existing items in the budget. I repeat that. This is a Supreme Court decision. The power to augment cannot be used to fund non-existing items in the budget. This is an interpretation of the Supreme Court of the constitutional prohibition on rules of augmentation. I repeat, this is an interpretation by the highest court of the land on what the Constitution means, what the prohibition against augmentation or on augmentation is means. And that cannot be changed by law, even assuming that Executive Secretary Bersamin is correct. Then the provision is cannot be enforced in the face of this Supreme Court decision, which clearly stated that you cannot augment items that are on non-existing items. And I haven't checked, but I would like to think that Secretary Bersamin was the Chief Justice at the time and participated in the decision. I repeat, this is a decision interpreting the Constitution, and therefore Congress cannot pass a law which would violate this.
Because no less than the Commission on Audit, state auditors flagged the office of the Vice President for creating these satellite offices, which they claim she did not follow procurement rules, right? The COA said confidential as well as intelligence funds require explicit congressional authorization. So ang tanong dito, was there a grave abuse of discretion on the president's end here? I mean, just objectively speaking, and can this be an impeachable offense?
I would not comment on that. I do not have possession of all the facts, but what I will make opinions on the basis of what I know to be the Constitution, of what I know to be the jurisprudence, of what I know to be the practice in Congress, and suggesting policies which can prevent the further deterioration of the situation. Remember that as we go on over the years, there will be increases in the confidential and intelligence funds budget. So this is something that we should take seriously. We before it goes out of hand. I think it's already going out of hand today, but we should adopt policies to prevent a further abuse of this privilege. Because I'll tell you, Karen, the allocation for intelligence confidential funds is one of the most abused items. Why? Because by the very nature of the expenses, you can liquidate the use of these funds through what we call the closed envelope system. Uh-huh. You put in the envelope your request. You put in an envelope how you disposed of these funds and submit it to the COA, and that's it. That's why it's called closed envelope, because it's not open to public scrutiny. Mm-mm. By the very nature of the funds.
Oo. Ang mahirap pag finlag na ng COA, because it's still audited, I think that's clear, right? It's audited, not for the public to see where you spent it, but when it's already audited by the COA, nagastos na ang pondo, diba? And you just told me there are no parameters. But then, isn't there some kind of boundary where you can spend confidential funds?
Well, theoretically, to gather, there are certain COA rules.
Simple. Can the Vice President decide, oh, I want more offices. I want to spend $200 million there. Eh, hindi naka-item yun sa budget. There's so many agencies fighting for an increase in their budget. And then suddenly, an office makes a decision, oh, I want more satellite offices. For whatever reason, right? That's not, kumbaga, hindi inilaban sa Kongreso.
If you want more satellite offices, that should have been provided in the regular budget.
Exactly.
A fund should have been requested when the budget was being prepared for satellite offices. You cannot use confidential funds for building satellite offices. Assuming that is true, I do not know. I have not seen documents. But you just on a theoretical premise, if you need funds for an activity, then you should make a proposal to the budget, and that proposal should find, if the budget approves it, that finds its way in the General Appropriations Act, and you utilize that, but not utilize the budget. Now, assuming that fund or the appropriation for satellite offices is not sufficient, then you can ask for augmentation. That's what the Supreme Court said, augmentation of an existing budget. Eh, pero kung wala namang item sa budget, hindi naman po pwede i-augment. That's what the Supreme Court said. If there is no item, you cannot augment. And there is no item for confidential and intelligence funds in the office of the vice president when we debated on the budget in 2021.
What do you make of President Marcos Jr.'s statement, which some have said it's the clearest and the strongest yet after the victory at the tribunal?
First of all, Karen, I would like to state that many critics criticize the ASEAN Forum as a useless talking shop. It is being criticized as that because wala magawa. But having said that, I fully support the attendance of President Marcos Jr. in the forum. I repeat, while indeed there is some validity to the criticism that the Asian Forum is a useless talking shop, I fully support the attendance of the president in the ASEAN Forum. Why? Because this provides us, a small nation, with a venue through which we can engage China in the West Philippine Sea and work on our fellow ASEAN members to have a common approach to the West Philippine Sea issue. Because in world politics, you know, it's almost true that strength is what makes things right, which should not be the case. But that is why the Asian Forum is an opportunity for us to expound and bring to world attention the West Philippine Sea problem, because we have no way of engaging and winning the debate with China alone. It must be a multilateral approach. And that the ASEAN provides us with that opportunity. That is why I fully support the statement of attendance of the president in the forum and his very strong statements. That is the only way that we can bring this to world attention. Although, not much can be done in the ASEAN, but you use it as a forum to expound on your views. You know, Karen, look at Myanmar. ASEAN does not do anything. Myanmar, military junta, deposed Aung San Suu Kyi in 2021, if I recall. But up to now, they could not do anything because the ASEAN rule is unanimity. If someone objects, you cannot have a policy pronouncement. You cannot have a communique. And in the case of Myanmar, obviously, Myanmar is a problem. I heard it from our top diplomats. Myanmar is a problem in ASEAN because they violate all rules. The military junta deposed a democratically elected leader and imprisoned her. Up to now, ASEAN could not do anything. They could not even expel Myanmar, because to take action, you need unanimity. And of course, you cannot get unanimity insofar as that issue is concerned. In the same manner, it is extremely difficult to get unanimity on the West Philippine Sea because of the influence of China. That cannot be denied. But we must not give up. We must not give up on bringing to the attention of the world through the ASEAN Forum where we stand. And again, just to reiterate, I support the president's position insofar as his attendance is concerned, as contrasted to the previous government administration and the strong statement he made on the West Philippine Sea.
All right. Now, the Senate, they came out with a resolution to actually bring this before the UN General Assembly. And that was even before China released their new map, which is from the 9-line. It's now a 10-line map. Where do you think should we go from here as a country?
Where do I think what? I'm sorry.
Where should we go from here as a country?
Well, we keep on bringing this to the international forum. I have my reservations. about bringing it to the General Assembly of the UN and attempt to have a resolution of the UN Assembly. That will never happen because China will always oppose it. But what we're doing today is to keep on bringing it up to in the international forum through the UN, through protests made, a formal diplomatic protest through the ASEAN forum. That is the only way that
but
we
can. Why? I wanted to ask you, that's a good one. Why don't you think we should bring it to the UNGA right now? What are your reservations?
I have my reservations about putting it to a vote in the UN General Assembly. I repeat that I have my reservations about putting the issue to a vote. Why? Because we have already won the arbitration. The legal issue has been resolved. So why do you place that legal issue in a political forum like the UN? Doesn't make sense. But we should continue to expose violations of international order in the way China has been handling the issue in the West Philippine Sea.
Okay, if you were still a senator today, do you believe, would you propose a review of the mutual defense treaty? There were talks that essentially acts that China's been doing in the West Philippine Sea, the use of a water cannon, the use of a laser light, they're what they call in the gray zone. It's not exactly an armed attack, right? So would you want a review of the mutual defense treaty?
Yes, I would favor a review of the mutual defense treaty. This treaty was signed, I think, in the 50s, if I'm not mistaken, and the world has changed since that time. And there are many gray areas there, one of which is when is a treaty partner obliged to come to our defense. It is in accordance, and if I recall correctly, the mutual defense treaty, it uses basically in accordance with its constitutional processes. In the United States, that means declaration of war. And, it's extremely unrealistic. So I would favor a review of the mutual defense treaty. As I said, these are decades old treaty obligation which we entered into. The world has changed.
All right. Okay. Before we go, I wanted to ask you, moving back as we close, do you believe that confidential funds have become more of a political accommodation today?
I hate to say this, but the answer is yes. But remember that Congress is a political body, and therefore political considerations come into play when you scrutinize the budget. But that is why I am suggesting clear guidelines, as in you cannot appropriate confidential intelligence funds where the agency is not gathering information. Only you can only, you should only allocate, as a matter of principle, CIF or confidential intelligence funds to those agencies which are gathering information, not the agencies which are users of the information. So that is the only way that we can at least minimize political considerations when you talk about intelligence and confidential funds.
All right. On that note, former Senate President Franklin Drilon, thank you for joining me today, sir.
Thank you, Karen, for having me today. I hope to see you again.